Hi, I'm Kevin Hogan, president of Rock Island Auction Company. It's my distinct pleasure to welcome you to our fabulous upcoming April 24th, 25, 26th Premier Firearms Auction, our first Premier sale of 2020. And it's too hard. It's impossible to get into the names, the known collections, because it's so vast. I can tell you the auction is absolutely extraordinary. It's less lots than you're accustomed to, and the quality is absolutely through the roof. One of the collections we've introduced you to in 2019 was the Dr. Gerald Klaas collection, synonymous with high art European guns, Smith and Wessons, and of course Volcanics is what we're here to talk about today. But it's so much more than that. I mean, we knew that we were going to have the ability to make this video, to put this table together, and it's perplexing. What do you call it? How do you title something so profound and important? And that's what we have here today, because, you know, what does this table represent so much? It is the birth of the lever action rifle. It is the forming of two titans of American firearms manufacturing, Smith and Wesson, and of course Winchester repeating arms. And it's all right here, and it happens so quickly. Of course, you know, and what this is all about is repeating firearms. Now, repeating firearms, it's nothing new. It's centuries old. Of course, back to the beginning of warfare, of course, more projectiles is more important. The more we can fire, the better. And that's what this speaks to. But we can see, kind of the big bang, if you will, for how that progressed. And it's right here. I mean, literally right here. I mean, you can go back to, but, you know, repeating firearms, not really a new thing, especially when you're talking about long arms and pistols. Of course, we have the revolver, which is what they you know, we tried to do essentially, go back to the 18th century, 1718 with the puckle gun. You know, that's widely recognized as the first repeating firearm. And there's so many nuance, and that's what this video is going to be all about. It's all about nuance. But go back to the 1839 Patterson carbine, which we have in this sale, the 1855, the North and Skinner revolving rifles, the Colliers. I mean, it's all here. But this is where it all comes together. And so we're excited to present this table. It's extremely important. I'm going to try to avoid getting too deep into the scholarly and let the guns tell the narrative of firearms manufacturing, of the repeating rifle, of the repeating firearm in American history. And, you know, the obvious place to start is with the Jennings rifle. I mean, kind of the epicenter of the first widely produced rifle, if you will. And at the time, I mean, at Robbins and Lawrence are manufacturing the Jennings rifle, and we haven't seen a gathering of talent like this go 100 years later toward the Beatles form up in Liverpool. I mean, at Robbins and Lawrence, you have Horace Smith, D.B. Wesson, Cortland Palmer, B. Tyler Henry. They're all there at Robbins and Lawrence. And, you know, Horace Smith, people do forget, he was widely recognized as the finest and best gunsmith in New England. And they're all working on this Jennings rifle. And the example that we have, again, is from the Klaas collection. It's an absolutely spectacular example of a Jennings rifle, the finest that we have ever offered, certainly in the top 1 or 2% of known Jennings rifles. But really, then we move next, and we have the Smith-Jennings, where these guys get together, and they say, we can improve this. And this is the only known example of a Smith-Jennings pistol. It's well documented in the Volcanic book. And, you know, here's your shot. It's the only one known. Dr. Klaas bought this gun in the late 70s out of I think it was a Christie's or Sotheby's auction. And it's been in his collection ever since. So that's the other appeal about this auction. This stuff is so monumentally fresh. Many of these opportunities will be offered, when I say publicly, for the first time. That means, you know, anybody around the world can raise their hand and own it. Previously in gun collecting, it was a lot of private sales, private treaties, where you had the opportunity to buy this gun. The obvious appeal of the auction world is letting that out to the world, and letting people decide what stuff's worth. And it's great competition, but it's that opportunity that we extend to everybody. So from the Smith-Jennings pistol, we have Horace Smith, D.B. Wesson, Cortland Palmer get together, and they form the Smith & Wesson Company. Not what you think of today. This was their first endeavor into improving their Smith-Jennings pistol design. And what they did is they produced two variations. They did a large frame and a small frame, not called Volcanics yet. We'll get to that down the road. These were coined as lever-action pistols, lever-action magazine pistols, because Cortland Palmer, he owned the patent on the actual magazine. So here is Smith & Wesson's first attempt with, again, Cortland Palmer's Patton, and again with B. Tyler Henry helping in the design. And now these two examples, they are benchmark examples. They are the finest examples that we have ever offered. I'll start with the large frame here. And it's all nuance. Again, it's nuance, nuance, nuance. But for condition, it's unrivaled, unparalleled for anything that we've ever offered. Tons of original blue on the frame. I mean, you're happy with crisp and sharp edges on these guns. Most of them are, even the really great ones are toned, even gray, kind of like they are back here. But to see original blue finish on the frame is so, so, so rare. Browning on the barrel. It's an earlier model. Again, it's nuance. But the rounded follower, the collar is the first variation, and the ring trigger has the spur on it. And so you'll see three or four variations of the large frames, but out of any of the variations, this is without a question the finest example that we have ever offered. And then right below it, I mean, we talk about great, and this gun is great in its own right. This gun is on an entirely different planet. It ranks up there. I mean, we had a really great iron frame Henry several years ago. It came out of the McCroskey collection. And again, talking about cumulative rarity, a good iron frame, you're again happy, sharp edges, crisp edges. And this gun speaks to me so much. And it reminds me of that gun because it is light years in front of anything else. Look at all the original blue on the frame. It's inky. We call it inky just the way that blue is. Totally soaks it up. And there's no A or B side. Both sides are equally magnificent. Again, original brown on the barrel. And how could I forget? Both of these are factory cased. We've never had an example of a factory cased Smith & Wesson lever action magazine pistol, let alone in condition that is more or less unrivaled. We're just kind of showing off here, but this is the depth of this sale. You know, here we have the number one pistol cartridges, here we have the number two pistol cartridges, and here's a box of number two pistol cartridges. The box is empty. What I think is so cool, there's a really old sticker. It's impossible to say how old the sticker is, but they were selling these, selling the cartridges. They were, it was 10 for $100, and that's an old sticker, ladies and gentlemen, a very old sticker. So we're just showing off, but to show you the depth of this sale and to show you what this collection means, nothing like this has ever been put together before. Nothing like this has ever been offered together before. So it's very exciting. Pound for pound, the best gun in the auction, probably the most important gun that we've ever had the opportunity to offer is sitting right here. Now, I don't think it's gonna be the most expensive gun we've ever sold, but again, it is no question one of the more important, if not the most important guns. And this is the genesis of the lever action rifle. This is where it all starts right here. At the conclusion of the original Smith & Wesson company, Smith & Wesson's, and this is all 1852, 1853, 1854. Well, by 1855, 1856, Smith & Wesson says, we're going in a different direction. And this was their kind of their swan song, if you will. We're going in a different direction. They sell Smith & Wesson to Oliver Winchester and a group out of New York. And so this again is their swan song. It's one of the last things that they did. They said we can turn this design into a rifle. And of course, what we're talking about here is, you know, they were improving not only the guns and function, but of course the ammunition. And so it's so many problems. This is why I said it's kind of the big bang. They're saying, how can we get a self-contained metallic cartridge? How can we get a self-contained cartridge to fire and have the magazines to be able to repeatedly fire and fire? And so this is one of three known Smith & Wesson rifles. I call it a carbine. I truly believe it's a carbine. It's one of three known. It's the only one that we are aware of that is in private circulation. The other example is maintained. There's a big 50 caliber rifle. It's at the Cody Museum. There's another example that's at the Milwaukee Art Institute. And then this, and not only is it the only one in private circulation, but of any of the three, it's the finest that there is. It's almost an exhibition gun. It was maintained by the Wesson family, but you can see, tons of original nickel finish, the factory engraving, and you know, most iconic and notably is the partnership handshake, memorialized for eternity on the left side of this stock. We can say it's the partnership between D.B. Wesson and Horace Smith. You could say it's the selling of the company from Smith and Wesson to Volcanic, which would eventually be Winchester, but it most certainly signifies partnership and really the creation of something so, so important. And that's what makes this gun great. Again, it's all in the details. I mean, the details are spectacular. You have the German silver on the stock, case-hardened lever, which is also engraved, and the engineering on it is spectacular. They put a lot of time into this, and you know, again, this gun was maintained by the Wesson family until approximately 1975. It was then sold through Abercrombie & Fitch to Alan Kelly. Alan Kelly sold it to Calhoun Norton, and Calhoun Norton sold this gun to Dr. Klass. And this is all, it was sold in 75 by Alan Kelly to Norton. I think Norton sold it in the early to mid 80s to Dr. Klass, and that's why this is being offered for sale publicly for the first time. So here's a chance to own one of the most significant firearms. It's the birth of Smith & Wesson and the birth of Winchester. Why do I say it's the birth of Smith & Wesson? Well, Smith & Wesson sells the company and they go in a different direction. They go to pursue Roland White and the self-contained metallic cartridge and starting producing revolvers, the bored through cylinder. That's where Smith & Wesson deviated. Now, Oliver Winchester sees the potential in lever action firearms. He takes this design, and again, it's a nuance. They form a company called the Volcanic Repeating Arms Company. There are several variations of Volcanic Repeating Arms on this table. To my left, an absolutely fantastic silver-plated, factory-engraved, ivory grip, might I say cased, with cartridges. This was manufactured by the Volcanic Arms Company. There's also a 16-inch carbine in the sale that was manufactured by the Volcanic Arms Company. It couldn't make the table. It's a great gun. We just ran out of space, and I wanted to show variation. We almost have every variation of a Volcanic firearm. Speaking of Volcanic, why do they call it Volcanic? Well, the story goes is that they were trying to, it's a marketing tool. They wanted to compare it to a volcano, the rapid fire of a volcano, the rapid fire of a pistol. So a great marketing name. The Volcanic Arms Company, again, they go bust. And Oliver Winchester takes it, and then he forms the New Haven Arms Company. And so now we can start seeing the evolution of where we're gonna eventually get to is the Winchester. And there's some profound rarities here by the New Haven Arms Company. Most notably is the pistol carbine. So, 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 so rare. Again, factory cased, New Haven Arms Company, pistol carbine. Again, what makes it so rare is that as these companies they go defunct and are reformed, they're taking parts, they're using parts, and they're still making the same models. And so to have these were primarily manufactured by the Volcanic Arms Company. Again, New Haven takes over, and this is one assembled by the New Haven Arms Company. So it's a nuance, but it's a super rarity. And then right below it, we have examples of the number one Volcanic pistol and the number one Target. And not only are they rare, but they're spectacular. So much original blue, beautiful case hardening. And again, it just to show the depth and depth and depth. And then right behind it, we'll finish up with one of two or three carbines that are in the sale. Again, nuance rarity, again, by the New Haven Arms Company, but it's a 25-inch factory engraved Volcanic carbine. The 25 inches, they're the rarest of all the carbines. Again, there's a 16-inch gun in the sale. I believe there's a 21-inch gun in the sale as well. So, you know, this table in this auction, we have every variation of a Volcanic, more or less. And as I talked about in the beginning of this video, is that this all happened so quickly. We have, you know, beginning of 1850, 1851, 1852, 1853, 1854, 1855, 1856, and where we're going to is the New Haven Arms Company and the outbreak of the Civil War with Benjamin Tyler Henry. We come up with the Henry rifle, and this is the evolution, less than a decade that it took to come up with the Henry lever action rifle. And this is one of the examples that we have in the sale. It's an outstanding, outstanding example of a Henry. You know, one of the top two or three that we've ever offered. Tons of original blue, and it's just so interesting to see how quickly it developed, because again, it's not just the mechanisms, but it's also the ammunition. And here we have the Henry 44 ammunition. What we went, and then just to take it one step further again, to show off just a little bit, to show you how important, how great, how special this auction really is. Not only do we have a superb example of a Henry, let's talk about really the first production Winchester, which is the Winchester 1866, the first model named using the Winchester name. And when I say first model, it is a first model. We sold this gun several years back out of the Dick Hammer collection. And what I mean by first model, it's a flat side. It's a flat side 1866. So obviously, again, firearms design is all about being pragmatic, always about trying to improve. How can we do it better? How can we do it better? The Henry rifle was great, totally revolutionary at the time, but the Civil War exposed, you know, many flaws. Exposed magazine tube and the loading system was archaic. And so a guy by the name of Nelson King said, hey, let's cut a loading gate in the side of a Henry rifle. And so you'll see the Briggs patent Henrys, but then this is truly the first model for a Winchester rifle, which is the 1866, but it's a first model 1866 being the flat side. Again, later they would dish the loading gate out and improve it some more, but this is no question. Again, like I said, we sold it a few years back. It doesn't get any better for a first model 1866 flat side. Deluxe presentation wood, condition, and it's still a Henry Mark barrel. So what a video. It's really hard to do this stuff justice. There's so much to discuss. And that's kind of the theme throughout this sale. For depth, it's out of this world. For superb, profound, when I say profound, I truly mean that. Opportunities to put stuff in your collection that for any amount of money, and at any given time, you will not have the opportunity to do so again. Case in point is the carbine, or the first model 66, this great Henry, the Jennings. I mean, it's all there. Find a better one. It is the best. So that's what this auction represents. And again, it's not just this table. Percussion Colts, Winchesters, U.S. military. It is absolutely endless. It's a special, special, special auction. I hope our catalog does it justice. And I hope we were able to do this justice and let the guns kind of tell the story without getting too technical with it. I'm sure I missed a few things, but it's a special group of guns. We were excited to put this together. For more information about our auction, visit our website, www.rockislandauction.com. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. Again, don't forget about our preview day, April 23rd. It's open to the public. It's Thursday. All these great guns and so many more, about 2,400 guns. Great friends, great guns. We put a party on, so it's truly an event in every sense of the word. And then the auction is the 24th, 25th, and 26th. Mark it in your calendars. Hope to see you then.